This podcast is brought to you by Free Buddhist Audio, the Dharma for your life. Our work is funded entirely by donations from our generous listeners. If you would like to help us keep this free, make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. Thank you and happy listening.
I try and be an example of sanity and compassion in the world. It's an aspiration. So when I say that that's the title of this talk, I'm not necessarily directly talking about myself, just to say. So this order weekend is based on a particular talk of Bhante's that he gave in 1984 called Buddhism, World Peace and Nuclear War, which I know is a great favourite amongst some of you. And in this talk, he was outlining not only his response to the threat of nuclear war, but the difficulties that we face in society, that we seem to face again and again and again. The difficulty of conflict and violence, of misunderstandings and miscomprehension, the difficulties of fighting and quarrelling. So it's called Buddhism, World Peace and Nuclear War, but we could substitute nuclear war for environmental destruction or racial prejudice or dictatorships or whatever it is that's the current world ill. And Bhante's response to the difficulties of nuclear war, of conflict and violence itself, is profound and far-reaching. He talks about how we should respond collectively and individually to the threat of nuclear war, and how we should actively promote peace. And you kind of get to this point in the talk where you think, no, that's really helpful advice, really helpful advice. I can see how it would apply to us now in our current situation and in the Buddhist centre itself. And then he hits you with another level. He goes deeper and deeper, further into the issues involved. Akasa Jyoti was calling it a graduated discourse. And I was thinking, yes, it is like that. To me, it's almost like a further revelation of the depth of the problem, the depth and the profundity of the problems that we face. Because he says, even if you solve the problem of war, even if you have world peace, you still have the problem of death. And there has to be an answer that transcends both war and peace and life and death itself. So what I'm going to do this morning is really just give you an outline of the talk and a few points about them to reflect upon. So Bhante gave this talk in 1984, and for those of you for whom that date is familiar, you'll know it's echoing George Orwell's novel of a dystopian future of the same name. And I was looking up what happened in 1984. I was myself 6 years old, so I can't actually really remember. I can remember that moon boots were in fashion and I had a rather fine pair. Grey with little red stripes. Anyway, I don't think that was in Bhante's mind, but on more important levels, the miners' strike had just started. The first Apple personal computer had gone on the market. Indian troops had entered the Sikh temple of Amritsar, killing about 500 Sikhs, and Indira Gandhi was assassinated after Bhante gave his talk. The Olympics was just about to be held in the US, but was boycotted by the Soviet Union. So there were still tensions between the US and the Soviet Union. And the campaign for nuclear disarmament gained pace, and its membership swelled, particularly in the light of an increase in nuclear armament in the US. So this is where sort of CND and groups like that really achieved their peak. And it was a great political battleground. So the Labour Party, the UK Labour Party, was committed to nuclear disarmament. That was one of its manifestos. And in the 1980s, we saw major protests against nuclear war, the biggest that there's ever been. In 1982, there was the biggest political protest ever in the United States, with 1 million people protesting about nuclear armament in New York City. And in the UK, there were protests such as Greenham Common, which I think we're going to hear about a bit tomorrow. And the biggest demonstration CND ever had, with 200,000 people protesting. And for some reason, when I was looking in the internet, I ended up looking at this kind of special branch file release, which doesn't sound hilarious, but it kind of was. It says that there was, even through the CND sort of marches and protests, there was a very low risk of public disorder, which is interesting. They classified it as a low risk. And then there was this little detail that in July 1983, there was a 7,000 strong human chain linking the US to the Soviet embassy. And there was only one arrest, and that was from insulting behaviour by a streaker who may or may not have been associated with the protest. So that was 1984. Today, we still have nuclear arms, as much as there ever were. But it's not such a visible issue, interestingly, despite the number of countries who have them and the ongoing debate over the treaties that stop us using them. At the same time, we've got an estimated 300,000 people marching in London to call for a ceasefire in Gaza, and 100,000 people marching against anti-Semitism. And again, the vast majority of those protests are peaceful. And this morning, fighting renewed in Israel and Gaza, despite a temporary ceasefire. And as you can hear, we all have a response to that, to all sides of conflict. We hear stories on the news more than we ever did. We have our own personal experience, and we're also more aware of the personal experience of others. And within us as human beings, there is an inbuilt desire to respond to all of it. That's a natural feature of human beings, of the human mind itself. There's a responsiveness to others. We are not separate from society. We are part of society. And what one part of society feels, we also feel. So this raises, I think, two important questions. One of them is, should we as Buddhists have a particular Buddhist response to any particular conflict? You know, is there a response that we should have, a side that we should take, that we need to, for example, issue as statements from our local Buddhist centres? Is there a particular Buddhist response? Or should we just reiterate the general principle of love and compassion? So is there a particular Buddhist response to any particular conflict? And I think the second question is a better world possible? Is a better world possible, or should we resign ourselves to the endless cycle of greed, hatred and delusion, expressed here as war, here as environmental destruction, here as poverty, here as oppression? So is it something that we should really kind of fight for? Should we fight for a better world, or should we resign ourselves to what the Buddha called, he said, there's no beginning to samsara, and the cycle of beings hindered by ignorance and fettered by craving, even if within that there is a possibility of a spiral path? So those questions, in a way, I think they're something that we have to reflect on, and you might want to discuss them in your chapter groupings. I'm not going to give you a complete answer to those or what I think the answer is. I think if one really wants an answer, I really do recommend listening to the whole talk itself. It's over an hour and a half, just to warn you. So make yourself comfortable. But I do think it's very... There's so much in it that I couldn't possibly recap, if you said, or summarise. But I just want to go into a few basic principles. So the first is... Sangharakshita's analysis of the problem. So the first point that he makes is that there's a cycle in play as old as time. He starts off by talking about the Rohini incident, which you might remember, which is when the Buddha prevented a war between the Shakyans and the Kolians, who is his mother and his father's clan, or his father and his mother's clan, who were both fighting over access to water. So it's quite a famous incident in the life of the Buddha. And I'm going to read you what he says, because I couldn't summarise it better than myself, really. It's quite an extraordinary paragraph. He says, there is the same clash of vital interests between different groups of people, the same unwillingness to compromise, the same dreadful escalation from harsh words to isolated acts of violence, from isolated acts of violence to preparations for full-scale war. There is the same fatal spirit of belligerence, the same readiness on the part of large numbers of people to fight without really knowing what they are fighting for. There is even, we note, the same irrelevant mutual vilification, suggestive of antipathies that have long lurked beneath the surface and now have an opportunity of breaking out. But there is also, and this is more encouraging, the same solitary voice of sanity and compassion that if only we listen carefully enough, we can hear even today. There is the same appeal to reason, the same reminder of what is truly most valuable, that has been heard, if not from the Stone Age, then at least from the Axial Age, and heard perhaps with increasing frequency, regardless of whether we pay attention to it or not. So wars, conflict are not new. In fact, I was looking at the oldest part of the Pali canon, the chapter of the eight, and most of that is the Buddha talking about fighting and quarrelling. They're nothing new. They're an escalation of hatred, which is really an escalation of frustrated desire. And when you get frustrated desire activated by the scarcity of resources, then you get anger, then you get hatred, then you get rage and violence. There's a seed of antipathy. I shouldn't have written this in my notes because I clearly can't actually say it. But anyway, antipathy. There's a seed of antipathy. There's a seed of kind of mutual dislike. There's a tension between me and you, self and other. And in certain conditions, that flourishes. Those things that we haven't sorted out, that kind of little grudge that we hold, that we can put aside and just try and get on with it. In the right conditions, there's a little seed there and that flourishes. The seed of otherness. And there is also a voice of sanity and compassion. Sangharakshita, in this talk, he talks about the two great forces of violence and non-violence, of violence and love. And he says they're always at work in the world, moving between each other, fighting for supremacy. It's interesting, actually. I was reading Dickens. I've got back into Dickens, partly because he's hilarious. But anyway, he said something, a little comment, which I then heard again from someone else, where he says, but the thing that you see over time is that evil goes quickly, whereas love endures. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I don't know if that's true, but I hope it is true. And Dickens was a great, astute observer of the human race, so I'm hoping it is true. Love endures. So there's these two great forces. And that's two great forces, not just in the collective, but also within us. Two great forces within us. A repeating theme in wars is identification with one group as opposed to another. Sangharakshita actually has quite an interesting discussion of the difference between nationalism and patriotism. And he calls nationalism the curse of modern history. We can also look at other groups where identification is held in opposition to other groups, as one group as opposed to another. And if you get that situation of over-identification or solidifying your identification, a nation, a government, a tribe sees their own interests as paramount, particularly when resources are seen to be limited. There's a division of the collective into us and other are to blame for the lack of resources. And that division is deep within the mind itself, and it's and deep within society itself. It's something that happens within the individual that's then expressed in the collective. This is Ambedkar's great vision, that division is it within the mind itself, but it expresses itself in society. And he famously said, what the mind creates, the mind can undo. Self and other. One group's interests at the expense of another's. My interests at the expense of yours. And Sangharakshita says it's very different from patriotism, which is a love and care, a pride of where you came from. And a sense that our place is to be loved just it's because it's a place in the world. And we love our place because we love the world, which I think is rather lovely. It's taken me a while to love tooting, I've got to say. But I do. So, yes, so that's one analysis, is there's a cycle at play that's as old as time. But also there's a second very, very interesting analysis. I really do recommend you listen to this or read it and really reflect upon it. Because he says there's a breakdown in communication. At the time of the Buddha, at least you had a discourse where people could understand what the other person says. But he says now it's not just languages that stop us from understanding each other. There's a breakdown of a notion of what is objective truth. The notion of truth is not separated from subjective feelings and personal interests. And he says loyalty to the objective truth becomes selective, which basically means we decide what we want to believe, and what we want to believe is we decide is true. He says there's a substitution of the notion of objective truth with the notion of subjective truth. When I started to listen to that, I just was, I almost had to sort of stop and take that in, because I thought that is so prescient. This was 1984, and how much more has that come into being more recently? In 2016, the Oxford word of the year was post-truth. What does that even mean? What it means is that there's not the truth, but my truth. Not what is true, but who holds the narrative that I'm going to adhere to. And then you get this division of opposing parties with no perceivable overlap of anything that they can agree about. There's no perceivable overlap of what's true. It's not even that they've got a different interpretation of what's true. There's no agreement of actual factual accuracy, which means the means of communication is lost because you're talking about entirely different things. And it's kind of genius, really. He says the other side's opinions are not regarded as lies exactly, but just non-facts. And I think in a way it would be easier in these discussions if it was just like if you said to someone, well, you're lying, because then at least you're trying to get to the same facts. But there's no suggestion of getting to facts or a shared objective truth. There's just non-facts. So it suggests a kind of dismissal, which means that the other side's views and opinions are just not even worth bothering about or not even worth discussing. They're just non-facts, which really reminds me of the quarrel at Kasambi. I don't know if you remember, the phrase is that they were stabbing each other with verbal daggers, where neither side could be persuaded, nor could they persuade. How much more is that the case today with social media? I've been listening to a series actually on Spotify called The Witch Trials of J.K. Rowling, which is about J.K. Rowling, but it's actually more about social media and what's happened, particularly just before the lockdown and during the lockdown, and the effect of social media. And what happens is that as social media has taken off, it confirms our selective narrative, which suits our own interests, It provides us with what's called an echo chamber, where you just hear the same opinions reflected back, and the same facts, or the same uses facts of facts, selected back. And then the narrative becomes very, very split. There's no common ground, because you can become more and more polarised. I even noticed this before with the Brexit debate in the UK. There was a lot about we don't want to listen to experts. I was thinking, oh, that's interesting. Why would you not want to listen to experts? You know, well, just because they're experts, it doesn't mean that we need to believe them. I was thinking, well, it might be worth considering what they say if they've spent their whole life studying the EU. There's a sort of bedrock of people saying, well, I will decide what I want to believe, and that will be based on my preconceived ideas and interests. And what you get then is an increasing polarisation between very right-wing views and very left-wing views. And it's very hard to maintain a voice of moderation. Things are becoming very, very split. And once they split, they have a tendency to become... to drift apart even further. And then Bhante says something even more than this. He says, okay, so that happens. The notion of objective truth is questioned, is substituted with the notion of subjective truth. But it's not just about a public discourse. He says it actually starts affecting a person. Because if some people's voices and opinions do not conform to another group's, what they think and say become also non-facts. And then there's a drift into that person becomes a non-fact. He says such an individual is not so much wrong as, in theory, non-existent. And since he is non-existent in theory, it is only natural that he should very quickly become non-existent in practice too. And then it doesn't matter what you do to that person. They don't agree with you, therefore they don't exist, or at least don't exist as a human being. They can lose their job, they can be subjected to violent threats, they can be frightened to leave their house, they are subjected to actual violence. And it doesn't matter, because they think something different from me. And that's what we've started to see in cancel culture. Cancel culture is not just cancelling a culture, it ends up being cancelling a human being. And I've seen that on both the right and the left. So this is the problem, the analysis of the problem. And what does he suggest as a solution? Well, he suggests as a solution the voice of sanity and compassion. In all this mess, there's the voice of the Buddha. And it's interesting because with a little help of Google Find, I looked up and he uses the phrase sanity and compassion 7 times in that talk. It happens again and again and again. It's rather beautiful, those twin values of sanity and compassion. I just read one of the paragraphs. He says, we shall be a voice of sanity and compassion in the world. We shall be able to appeal to reason. We shall be able to remind humanity in its own name what things are of greater value and what of less. We may even be able to remind it what is the most valuable thing of all. We shall be a voice of sanity and compassion in the world. So what are sanity and compassion? I think sanity comes from, it's more than reason, it's more than intellect. It comes from who we are. We know who we are. We know what we value. We know what there is to draw strength from. I was thinking of equivalent Pali term will probably be apamada or sampajana. Something about that kind of ethical heedfulness, that you're aware, you're centered, and you know what you're about. You've got a continuity of purpose and you know your values. I think it's something to do, I explore a lot in the using Qigong, and I know when I'm coming from my own voice of sanity, because I'm very much centered in my central channel. I'm increasingly sounding like a little bit of a hippie, but we'll overlook that. But I hope you know what I mean. Like, when I'm coming from the voice of sanity, I'm grounded and centered. When I'm not, I'm pushed forward or leaning back. There's something very strong in the central core. There's something very strong in the central core, for example, in the heart also. I think that's where the Bodhisattva's bija comes from. You know, you've got this something is at root in the centre of your being, which you know what you value and you know what you're about. I had this the other day, Punyamala. She suggested to me that I went to meditate in the morning in Bhante's living room. So I went to meditate in Bhante's living room. I had some questions that I was mulling over. And what I felt there, I was sort of, you know, I don't know if you do this. I still ask Bhante questions. And I hope for some really clear answer. And just as it is when he was alive, you don't quite get what you directly wanted. Hopefully you get something more. But what I got in touch with sitting in that room was a sense of incontrovertible faith. There is something which in me, which is a deep, deep faith. And I can't even put it into words, but what I felt was that in that room I was surrounded by Bhante and his teachers, and whatever was running through them runs through me. Whatever they say yes to, I say yes to on a very, very deep level. And I thought, it doesn't really matter what you do. The main thing is that you come from that place of, it's more than sanity, or it's the sanity that comes from faith. Let's put it like that, the sanity that comes from faith. And it's also compassion, the voice of sanity and compassion. And Bhante talks a lot about the compassion of seeing humanity as essentially one. I'll read you another little quote. He says, it means that we have to identify ourselves with humanity rather than with any particular section of it, and love humanity as ourselves. We have to feel for the different national communities and the different ethnic and linguistic groups, the same kind of love that we feel for the different limbs of our own bodies. And he recommends that we get a feel for humanity as a whole through travel and friendships with people from different cultures. He talks about aligning ourselves fully with the principle of love. I do find that when I'm in a situation of conflict, I say to myself, like, where is the deeper love here? Where is the deeper love? Where is the deeper creativity? Because we're now split into so many identities. It's not just national groups. It's sexuality, gender, religion, culture, race, political opinion. All these identifications that if we're not careful, they can move from a simple love for who we are and how we identify ourselves to a fixing of that in opposition to other. It's almost like the difference between patriotism and nationalism can be applied to any of those identities. It's not wrong to love, for example, your particular sexuality and to delight in that and to feel comfortable in that. But there is something wrong if you oppose others with different sexualities and put those with your sexualities' interests first, if you see what I mean. So yes, and it's not just that we have to then try and get a feeling for humanity as a whole by travel, but also by knowing different people with different backgrounds and different identifications, different sexualities, different genders, different religions, cultures, races, political opinions. We have to listen deeply to each other and see our common humanity, feel a common humanity between us all. The life that runs through us. Because we can't think anymore in terms of isolated societies and isolated groups. We can't separate ourselves off into different tribes. You know, I suspect that in the war between the Shakyans and the Kolians, that no one in what we call modern day Europe had any idea about that. But they would now. And what happens in one part of the world happens in all parts of the world. And I think part of that is due to media and the effect of media, but also the impact of our actions are upscaled. They're globally scaled. So our whole world economies are interlinked. You know, we really saw that with the war in Ukraine. You know, suddenly the prices of our own food changed and went up because of a war in Ukraine. We see the impact of that on pollution. You know, you can have one factory, one government making one policy about pollution. That's going to affect people living thousands of miles away in different parts of the world. Banti says that we have to think not only in geopolitical terms, but geoethical terms and geohumanitarian terms. We have to feel that we are one humanity. And it's no longer possible for us to have a policy that separates ourselves out. It's no longer possible for there to be a war between Israel and Gaza and us not to be implicated in that. So the second solution that he has is to speak with one voice. Again, he moves from an individual voice of sanity and compassion to a collective one. He says we need to work together as one voice and not be divided into different factions within that one voice. And he talks about seeing the divisions within those who are working towards the same end, which in this case was nuclear disarmament. But we can see that in all sorts of forums. And what it leads to is inaction and ineffectiveness. I remember one of the most sort of, in a way, sort of sad things that I've seen was about 10 years ago. 10 years ago, we went on pilgrimage with Sheffield and Sangharakshita was there. And we went to Dr. Ambedkar Museum outside Nagpur. You know, and Dr. Ambedkar is such a hero, you know. He did so much, one human being. So there was the museum, which was very run down at that point. And next to it was a patch of grass, which was cordoned off. And then it had a sign on it. And the sign said, "This is a Dharma training institute for young Buddhists." And it was just a patch of waste ground. And I said to the Manitama, I said, "What happened?" You know, he said, "Listen, there was loads of money. There was loads of money when Dr. Ambedkar died. But because of divisions within the Ambedkarite movement, none of it got spent. And this is what we have." Apparently, actually, they have started building on it now. Someone told me recently. But it was a sort of symbol of something. You know, if you don't act together, you can have all the money you like. You can't really do anything. So that's the solution that Banti talks about. And then he gives some very concrete action. He says to put non-violent pressure on governments and other citizens. He says even civil disobedience if needed. So could we have a single Buddhist response that's expressed in a statement through which we could put pressure on governments? I think it was much clearer in the case of nuclear disarmament. I think it was much clearer to say a Buddhist response to nuclear warheads is pretty much a no. But the causes today are so disputed, you know, particularly within our Sangha. You know, you've got some people who are very concerned about climate change and you've got other people who say it's just feeding anxiety. I'm not sure we can act as one Buddhist voice for an entire Buddhist movement, but we can act as individuals for the things that are important to us, and we can get together with other people in the Sangha to do that. We can use our vote, we can use petitions, we can use protests, we can use vigils. That's all advice from Sangharakshita. I think one thing I've seen, you know, particularly in response to the current crisis in the London Buddhist Centre, is there's meditations for peace and a deepening desire to understand the root of conflict and an exploration of that in Buddhist centres as a way that everyone can get behind, you know, looking at the desire for peace rather than analysis of the conflict. Although I think in some ways, I wonder if we could start a bit more debate. I did wonder at the time of Brexit whether we should have had more debate in a very skillful way. The art of debate is a wonderful thing. And I do wonder whether we could have that again. But Bhante has a little warning. He says, you must make sure that if you put non-violent pressure on governments or even on other people, that you act in accordance with what you believe to be in line with the Buddhist precepts. And you make sure that hatred and violence are not smuggled in. And that you're not using this particular cause for your own personal interests. He's got a good expression for this. He says, there must be no attempt to hijack the peace express. So, I know. Anyway, so there's a peace express. It's going through, steaming through the countryside. And there must be no attempt to hijack it with one's own selfish interests or unresolved trauma and negative mental states. And the answer to this is to encourage the widespread use of the metta bhavana. Which is important, actually. It resolves divisiveness in the mind. And, of course, what the mind creates, the mind can undo. If the mind has created divisions, and that's being expressed in society, the mind can undo those divisions with the metta bhavana. Don't underestimate it. It's our secret nuclear power. Woo! Guerrilla warfare. Okay, and the other thing, so there's non-violent pressure. He also says we must set an example, which I've talked about a bit. But I'll say again. He says one must also set an example. Setting an example, indeed, is the best way of taking the initiative or of giving a lead. And in the present instance, the example that is set has to be a very lofty one. It has to be an example of impartiality and detachment, an example of love for humanity as a whole, an example of genuine devotion to the achievement of world peace by non-violent means. It has to be an example of sanity and compassion. And we need to take that up in the individual sense, ourselves becoming a fourth sight, ourselves becoming an example of sanity and compassion, but also collectively becoming a fourth sight in the world of sanity and compassion. We have to speak with one voice beyond division. And in a way, when he talks about this, I think of a vision of the order itself. This is why I'm involved with ordination training. This is why, having seen so much suffering in the world, having been taken around a Palestinian refugee camp when I was 14. And I'll tell you, there's poverty and there's violence, and I've seen both. But to see the suffering of hopelessness is worse still. To see young people growing up without any opportunity for further education or any opportunity of a job or a life beyond being the third generation in a refugee camp is pretty grim. And in a way, the answer that I've come to from all of this is that I think the order can be a collective example of sanity and compassion in the world. Maybe we're not going to change the age-old cycle, but maybe we can collectively represent the Buddha as a voice, a united voice of sanity and compassion. Even if we don't agree on all points, we can even exemplify a compassionate response to our own disagreements between us. That is quite a powerful thing, to even have a standard of being able to disagree better, as it's called now. You know, that can be very powerful to watch two order members disagreeing helpfully. And at least we can collectively have an attempt to move from subjective truth to objective truth. And even if we do that, even if we as an order become a voice of sanity and compassion in the world, it's not enough. Bhante says, even if you have world peace, you still have the question of what to do with your life. We have in the UK a level of peace not experienced for many generations. And what do we do with it? One of the lines from the talk, Banti says, it would be a thousand pities if, when we had solved the problem of world peace, the gods were to look down on a world that in many respects resembled theirs, only to see us playing bingo or watching third-rate television programmes. And this was before the invention of Netflix. This was when, if you wanted to watch a movie on a Friday night, you had to go to Blockbusters and decide whether you're going to get the latest release, which was a bit more expensive, or the rubbish ones that were in the kind of shelves to the side. Remember those days? And I think this is also where the order can help people. We can help people to live a rich and meaningful life. I'm grateful to the order. I'm grateful for the opportunity of meaningful communication. And I'm grateful to the that sense that the Sangha has, what Banti called an oasis in the wilderness, where you can talk about meaningful things. I think that had such a big effect on me when I first came along, that people took me seriously. Like, what a gift that was to take a 17-year-old little punk seriously, you know. And I used to come around there crying because I had an argument with my parents, and they used to just stick me on the sofa with a cup of tea and a copy of Nietzsche. So, you know, I think we can help each other lead a meaningful life, a rich life, a life of joy and friendship and connectivity, a life where we can meditate together and be in silence together and study what's meaningful to us together. But even if we have a meaningful life, we haven't solved the problem of death. Even if we have world peace, we are still going to die, all of us. And not even us just as individuals, but society itself, even the human race itself on this planet is limited. And solving the problem of death doesn't mean living forever. It's solving the fear of death, the limitation of identification with this life. It's solving craving itself, the cycle of birth and death. It's attaining liberation, irreversible creativity and nibbana. Yes, we can be creative in this life. We can offer an example of sanity and compassion, but it's not irreversible creativity. That only comes when you're free of the cycle of birth and death. The transcendental has to be a presence within us and between us, like the moon above the trees. There's a very interesting sutta of the Buddha where he says, dark actions lead to dark results, and light actions lead to light results, and mixed actions lead to mixed results. Just get all the bases covered. He's talking about ethical actions, ethically dark actions, so unskillful actions lead to dark results. Skillful actions lead to light results. Mixed actions lead to mixed results. And then he says, but no actions lead to no results. And then someone asks him, but how do we cultivate no action and no result? And he says, you set up the intention from the beginning. I think that's very interesting. It's not that you've got to be completely liberated. It's not that you've got to be completely beyond the cycle of birth and death. To set up the intention to be completely liberated, to set up the intention to be beyond the cycle of birth and death. You know, I've seen a lot on social media about meditation as well-being, as a way to kind of visualize your potential and transform the neuroplasticity of the brain to become a kind of better you. And I think that's good because that will help us become sane and compassionate. But we can go much further than that. The visualization of our own sadhanas dissolves into shunyata. And I think we need to let that voice of sanity and compassion pass through the fires of shunyata. And I think that has a real effect even to set up the intention to do that. We can work for a better world. We must work for a better world. We must become a collective voice of sanity and compassion. We must bring in a prayer for well-being and peace. We must bring in a way to work through our problems together and a notion of objective truth. We can be a fourth sight. But in the end, we have to be something much, much more than that. And I think that's the real gift of the order. The gift of the order is to give a sense of something other. And it's not because we're necessarily all stream entrants, although I hope some of us are and will be. I think it's a sense that even on, we can work at things on a particular level, but it's contained within an attitude of shunyata. It's a bit like in the Vimalakirti Nidesha. At one point, the Buddha says, can you build in empty space? It's the literally used reply, well, no, you can't build in empty space. And so he says, and yet you might go ahead. And then he says, and just so, it's impossible to build a pure land, and yet one might go ahead. And I take that as great comfort, actually, that we've got to try. We've got to try to build the Buddha land. And yet it's all contained within empty space, within shunyata. There's another quote of the Buddha where he talks about having that still, calm, moonlight quality, where the shackles of constant becoming are cut and thrown away. The still, calm, moonlight quality, where the shackles of constant becoming are cut and thrown away. We can give the gift of what's beyond, subtle, guhya, secret, gambhira, deep, beyond the reach of reasoning. We can give the gift of no action with no results, beyond all victory and defeat. And I don't know, in a way, how we do that other than trying to cultivate it in our own practice, cultivating that in a communication between us, but also just maintaining that sense of mystery and otherness in everything that we do. And don't settle for something lower than we could be. So I'm going to just finish with two things. I'm going to finish with our lines of acceptance that we all took at our public ordination, and also the Bodhisattva vows. So with loyalty to my teachers, I accept this ordination. In harmony with friends and companions, I accept this ordination. For the attainment of enlightenment, I accept this ordination. And for the sake of all beings, I accept this ordination. Though the many beings are numberless, I vow to save them. Though greed, hatred, and delusion rise endlessly, I vow to cut them off. Though the Dharma is vast and fathomless, I vow to understand it. Though the Buddha's way is beyond attainment, I vow to embody it fully.
We hope you enjoyed this week's podcast. Please help us keep this free. Make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. And thank you.